My name is Jayaprada and I'm from Chennai. I work for a company called Unity Solutions as business analyst, and I have been working with Drupal related projects for the past 3 years, 3.5. So in this session, I'm going to deliver you my experiences on managing Drupal projects, how me and my team have encountered some of the problems and how we have overcome it. And mostly I will be talking about how we can bring agility to projects and some of the problems we have overcome using agile methods in Drupal projects. So to start with, first question would be, what is agile and why is it important? So if you could tell me your opinion about agile, what do you think of agile? What is the first word that comes in your mind when you say agile? Sprints, yeah, then? Yeah. Excellent, being flexible. Anything else? Okay, so let me explain a case study about FedEx. So many of you, or all of you, most of you would have heard about FedEx. It's a courier company. It basically picks a courier from one place and it delivers the courier to the other place. So FedEx in continental US, I don't know in remaining places, but in continental US it has two options. One is standard delivery and one is express delivery. It has so many options, but these are basically main options it has. It provides to its customers. One is a standard delivery and one is a express delivery. So as you have quietly guessed, express delivery means it will deliver your courier within a span of 24 hours. Okay, so it can be from any place to any place. So any FedEx employee, they don't know in which place this express delivery will get booked, or they don't know weight of the courier, or they don't know the fragility of the items that is in the courier, or they don't know the destination. At any point of time, they don't know anything. At any point of time, a customer can come to one place, can book an express courier in Florida and ask them to deliver it in Washington. So how do you think FedEx is managing this? Without knowing any parameters, without knowing when the order gets booked, how do you think FedEx is managing this process? Sorry? In? Not in parts, but okay. So what the FedEx is doing is, at any point in time, FedEx has empty planes in the air. They have empty planes running in the air. They call it spares in the air. So what happens is, typically when a customer books a courier, what happens is FedEx will direct this empty plane to that particular location, picks the courier and delivers it. So when you think in a lean perspective, most of you would have heard about lean techniques, right? Lean agile method. They would have listened to this process, they would have said it's a waste. But FedEx is still doing this particular express delivery in this way, and they are getting quite good results. They are a very good MNC. They are a profitable MNC. So basically, even though lean says waste, the important thing here the FedEx is doing is customer delivery. So by agile, I means efficient, effective, predictable delivery of customer value. It is sprints and flexibility are part of agile. Yes, definitely. But the end objective of any agile method is delivering the customer value in efficient and effective way and in a predictable way. That is what agile is. In my opinion, in three years span of projects I have dealt with, I came up with this definition. So why is agile important? As usual, when I said customer value, any project, the main agenda of any project or any organization is the customer value. If the customer is not there, you are not there. Customer is the only person with who is purpose of your whole existence. You exist because of the customer. So customer value is important. Then adaptability. As he rightly mentioned, Agile will help us to adapt to the situation and be flexible for the situation or the task. And visibility. One of the main Agile process, transparency. At any point of time, Agile says that be transparent to internal stakeholders as well as your clients. Let them know what is happening with the project. Let them know what are the troubles you're facing so that they can, and most of the times, clients will encourage this kind of openness and transparency. And risk mitigation. We will talk in future and further slides, but Agile helps in many ways to identify the risk and therefore reducing the risk. And then last but not least, team collaboration. All the Agile methods say one and only thing, team collaboration, Agile interactions. They talk again and again about not individual team performance or individual member performance, but interactions between teams and interactions between members. So, coming to the next topic, how values and principles can drive your process. So, the first question you have to ask when you're following an Agile methodology is, even as you are a developer, you are building something. Say, for example, you are configuring a newsletter. Why are you configuring a newsletter? What is the use of configuring a newsletter? Or if you're building a search functionality, why are you doing this? What is the use of doing this? You need to first think about what your customer expects from it, what your customer finds value. So first thing is talk to the customers. I'm not saying clients, to the customers. Say for example, you're building a website for children. What you need to do is first you need to talk to the children, not to the product owner or not to the company owner, to understand what really the end customers need. So first thing is you talk to your customers, then identify the value. Where is the value coming from? Is it coming from building a newsletter? Is it coming from building an e-commerce? Is it coming from FAQ session? In many of the insurance products, we think that because this is from a personal example, we have built a website for an insurance company. So when we sat with the clients, most of the clients, majority of the client stakeholders thought that the important functionality they need to have in a website is actually product information. They wanted to showcase the list of products they have, list of insurances they have. But actually when we spoke to their direct customers, we have identified that products are not the important things for the client customers who are coming to the website. They wanted to know FAQs, what kind of policy they wanted to get, what kind of policy they wanted to take, and what is the age limit, what are do's and don'ts. These kind of things they wanted to know first. So it is important for you to talk to your end customer rather than to clients. Then identify the value and measure the feasibility. Many a times our clients comes to us with a very long list of tasks and wishes, but you need to again understand the feasibility. Is the technology I'm using permits to me to do this? Am I capable of doing this? So measure the feasibility. And at last, check the competition, not your competition, your client's competition. What are they doing? How are they achieving their objectives? If you could go through this process, you can identify the correct customer values and deliver the customer satisfaction. So this is one of the projects we have worked on. Me and my team has built a e-learning portal. So the basic objective of the e-learning portal is it's a portal which was built for professionals. The professionals wanted to learn how to handle medical equipment. So that is the basic objective of the process. Halfway through the project, we realized that the requirements are never burning down. 2 months we are building the functionalities and delivering them, but the process is still going on and on. The project is actually scoped for 3 months, but by the end of 2 months, we realized that we are not even in the half. We are not even in the middle. And this is one of my first projects when I first joined the Drupal and started the project management and all. So in the middle of the, after 2 months, we realized that this is never going to work. So what we did is we have immediately adapted Scrum. And what we observed is, it's not that we are not building the requirements. It's not that we are not delivering the use cases or user stories to client. What's happening is additional requirements are coming in. And we did not take those additional user stories into account when we are building the product. So what happened is, even though we are giving an earned value to the customer, they fail to recognize it because the requirements are coming in and the client only sees the list of requirements, not what you have achieved. It's a mindset of any human being. So what happened is, when we adapted Scrum, we have taken Jira tool and we have produced a sprint burn down chart. So in that burn down chart, we were able to say, okay, in this sprint there were 30 user stories delivered, but there have been 20 user stories that got inside. That is the reason we were never able to show the end value to the customer. So agile methods and methodologies, what will happen is, they will allow you to, as I said, if you remember, a risk mitigation. It will allow you to see how the project is going on, how you can minimize the risk, and of course, feedback loops, sprint reviews for feedback loops. It will allow you to get the feedback from the customer and immediately implement it. Or otherwise, you can say that this is not possible because this is going to take longer time. We will do it in the next sprint. But either way, it will allow you to see how the project is going on. Then this project also involves Drupal front end to Totara back end. We are writing API calls to fetch data from Drupal to show in, from Totara to show in the Drupal front end. And this had a lot of focus and commitment. The team members had to sit, understand how Totara works. Then they had to write the API calls. All this comes when you are able to organize your process and show your customer that you are building the end value. Then you can confidently go to a client and say that, see, this is not an easy task to do. We are doing it. However, these are coming. You can do that only when you follow certain process. Then there is this another portal or campaign page where we had three campaign pages actually, where we had the turnaround day of only one. That is, in one day we had to build the campaign page and as well as push into the production and take it live. What we did is we had made two programmers to sit together. One was writing code, another one was reviewing the code, and then we have given that instructions to the infra team to take the site live. In 3 days, just 3 days, we have launched three campaign pages in such manner. And this is called HP programming. This is also one of the agile methodologies we have followed. So this comes to our next question. So does it mean that we need to learn all the agile methodologies? There are so many number of agile methodologies. If you have idea, there is Scrum, there is Kanban, there is HP programming, there is lean management. All these are agile methodologies. Many of us don't know this, but many of us practice tools and techniques in our daily lives. I'll show you examples how close we are practicing this agile methodologies in our daily life. But coming to the question here, no, it does not require to learn all the methodologies. You can basically learn one methodology, adapt it, understand the pros and cons, and ultimately we need to apply our common sense in solving the problems. So these are the key points to take away. Choose your process depending on the customer value you want to generate. So it can be anything. It can be Scrum or it can be Kanban. It can be anything, any process, any technique. But choose it well. Identify the customer value. Then choose it. then don't choose the process because it is easy or it is complex. Some may think sprints are very easy. Some may think Kanban. If you have an idea, there are Kanban boards. We follow process flow identification will be done in Kanban. So don't just skip from one process to other process just because of complexities. Understand it. You need to understand the process in order to apply it to your projects. Then. So practice the values and principles, and don't afraid to try permutation combinations. When you say sprints, it does not mean that you can adopt some of the techniques from Kanban or some other agile methods. So how do you measure effectiveness of projects? So we are all talking about customer value, flexibility, and all. How do you actually measure it? Who says that the one project is going well and one project is not going well? Or one project is a success and one project is a failure? Who can say that? Who can determine it? So this is one of my favorite quotes I have read again and again in so many books. Increased team performance lead to decreased system performance. In short, it says, if your individual member is performing very well or one team in your company is performing well, it means that as a whole, your system is fail. Why? I will explain you with an example. So I'm hoping all of you know how cricket is played, correct? You know rules and regulations, how runs are scored, when a player gets out. Everybody knows, right? So see in this picture, these two people are running, right? Dhoni and Virat. Dhoni and Virat are running, they are taking runs. So many of you know that to score a run, they need to run from one end of the pitch to the other end of the pitch. So tell me, in this scenario, just assume that Dhoni only cares for his run. He's not bothered about Virat. Okay, he's not bothered about Virat. He only cares for his run. He knows that he can make to the other end of the pitch without getting out, without wickets being fall. But he also knows that Virat cannot do it because the ball is in the Virat's place. So if Dhoni takes the run, what will happen? Virat will get out, correct? So here, individually, Dhoni is not doing anything wrong. His performance is perfect. He's delivering a wonderful performance. But what happening here is, overall, a wicket is getting out, a player is getting out, and the entire team is losing a wicket. Thereby, it leads to, loss of our cricket match, correct? The same happens with our agile processes as well, with our internal teams as well. When one team only focuses on delivering its value but neglects to interact with other teams, what will happen is Dhoni will keep the strike, Virat will get out. That's what will happen even in the teams. So I'll explain this through one of projects I have worked on. So this is the project. We have built a portal for MNC and we have built content recommendations. Like when a user comes into the website, he browses content, right? He browses different articles, he browses different blogs and all. So depending upon his browsing activity, what we are doing is we built a recommendation engine where it suggests some of the articles and blogs to the writer. So here, if you can see, there is a content team who is very exceptionally good at producing viral content. And there is a business team who makes decisions just like that. They don't take much time to make decisions, and they are they're easily funded. Everything is very good with the business team. Then there is a Google Analytics team, which is providing quotes and custom quotes, and which is allowing us to track the user cookies and all. And there is a development team who is doing their job perfectly. Everyone is doing their job perfectly. And then in the middle of all this activity, there is a user who browses the content. So basically what happened is everyone had provided extremely good job. The content team has delivered fantastic content. The development team has given excellent API calls and all. Everything is going perfect. When we went to this stage when we pushed this code to stage, what happened is we have faced an error from infra. The infra firewall was blocking our API calls. So 2 months we sat there, we built this recommendation engine, we did everything very perfectly, everyone is perfectly doing their job very perfect. What we missed is the interaction between the team. We did not check with the infra team whether our API calls will get past their firewall. So the interaction has failed. That's the reason why we took extra 1 more month just to solve that firewall block issue, and we had to rebuild and readjust the configurations in the recommendation engine. So this is where the interaction between teams come very, very important. It's not you delivering a fantastic code and you delivering a fantastic content, or we adapting agile process and all. It's about interaction between the teams that plays a major role and finishes the end product. So are you measuring your interactions? So one of the things is why we should measure the interactions is, I have listed a set of advantages like scope. It will help us to go into the right direction. It will mitigate the risk. It will help in being the process being transparent. Then there is the cost benefits, like it cut down the losses and resource allocation, less operational costs and quality and time. All this, you can achieve all this by just measuring your interactions. When you don't measure the interactions, you won't be able to say where your project is going. Then, okay, how should we measure these interactions? I have listed all the qualities and all, it's very nice. How can we measure these interactions? So the first thing is collect the data accurately. So how many of you, you set sprints, right? So during sprints, you're a Drupal developer. I'm sorry? Oh, you're a business analyst, okay. So you work with the development team, correct? So during development team, and you have work experience with Drupal team? Yeah. So when you work with them, did you notice that while creating a sprint planning or sprints or any task activity, how many of developers have taken Drupal patches, Drupal updates, and Drupal upgradations into account? The answer is almost zero. Drupal developers, generally, it's my experience that they never take these kind of activities into consideration, because of which there will be a time lag activity. So say they have spent 1 day upgrading the Drupal from 7 to 8. So that particular 1 day is a loss. We did not account it. It's not the loss in the sense it's a requirement, it's important, but the predictability of the system gets disrupted. So it is very important that we measure and we take into consideration each and every activity we are doing. Each and every activity, no matter is a small patch which will take only 2 hours to put or 15 minutes to put, no matter what, how much time it will take, but it is important that we consider it to maintain the stability and predictability of our system. And then collect the data precisely. So most of you may have heard the example of NASA, how NASA had lost millions worth of project because one team has measured in English metrics, whereas other team has measured in US metrics. So that is one of the story where NASA has launched some project, and two teams are working in two different locations. One team, they measured all the calculations using English system, kgs, meters, kilometers, and other team used conventional US metrics. So what happened is when they actually launched the project, the entire project collapsed and they have lost millions worth of inventory. So collecting your data in a precise manner is very, very important. Then customer feedback loops, these are very important. When you deliver a project or when you deliver a piece or when you deliver a piece of functionality, what will happen is the customer usually gives the feedback. This is not there, this color is not good, that color is not good. You need to place this block on the right side, something like that. So you need to, for the customer to give that feedback, first you need to produce the functionality. So don't wait until the end of the time or the last minute to deliver the piece of functionality to customer. Deliver it as soon as possible. You will get the feedback, you will have the time to implement it. And as general rule, 80% of the feedback occurs in within first 7 days, which is very, you know, which will help you to build the project. And at the end of the time, at the end of the project, you will not have any surprises. So you will be able to, Aram say, you will be able to deliver this, deliver your project. So this is one of the concepts I wanted to explain, flow deaths. So again, my insurance company where we have built the project, it's a decoupled Drupal. One part of the project is decoupled Drupal. So what basically we did is we have created a content type for them. That is a very large MNC, okay, but one of the India's biggest insurance company. We built a CMS for it. So being one of the India's largest insurance company, it has branches located in regions, then in cities, then in towns, then overall head office is there. So there are many hierarchy levels in the organization. So what we did is we have given them a workflow. Okay, these are all Drupal terminology, but again, so what we did is we have built a complex workflow, and we created up almost 40 to 50 content types, customized the content types for them. And what happened is, when we are creating this process is going on. We are creating one content type, and we have created a complex workflow for them. We're integrating both. That is functionality one, then there is functionality two, then there is functionality three. Like this, the functionalities are going on. What happened is the customer suddenly comes to us and says that, I want functionality E to be happen very fastly because that is very important for us. So what we do is, we generally when the customer comes to you and says that we want this, you build that, correct? So what we did is, if you see task E and task E2, we stopped working on task A and task B and task E1 and E2, we have completed it, finished off. What happened is, basically, whatever time and effort we need to spend on task A and task B, we have spent on task E1 and task E2. And this is called flow depth. In agile metrics, this process is called flooded. Flooded is nothing but you are borrowing the time and effort you have to put on one task and forcibly putting into other task. What will happen when we continue in this process is, if you see the task A and task B are saying, hey, I'm here. They're still in the flow. They will never get finished. Because the client comes back and says, E3 and E4 are important, please finish it off. If you see this kind of system, what it will lead is, it will lead to unpredictability. And at the end of the project, you will realize that you are not able to finish even half of the delivery items you need to finish. So be careful of these kind of things. Be careful of these kind of flow depths. Identify your flow depths. When you are expediting some of the functionalities you are building for your client, make sure you highlight them. Say to your client, communicate to your client saying that we are building this, so we are dropping task A and task B, and those task A and task B will be taken again in next sprint. Otherwise, you will never be able to finish it off. So that is called flow depth. So one principle for flow depth is, stop starting and start finishing. If you pull two items from the your backlog, first finish those two items, then take the next two items. Otherwise, you will never be able to finish anything anywhere. Okay, so this is one of the quote I have read somewhere, and effective leaders use goals, measures, and data to deliver customer value and reshape culture. And it is very true. You cannot go by your gut feeling in setting up the goals or achieving your goals. You need to measure them. Without measuring your goals and without data, it is nothing but a talk. These are key takeaways. So as I said, agility is not about agile teams. It is interactions between the agile teams. If you fail to interact with your coworker, or if your team is failed to interact with your core team, you will not be able to deliver a successful product. then it is important to measure the stability and predictability of the system and be consistent, accurate, and precise during data collection. Customer feedbacks were very important. Try to deliver the functionality as soon as possible so that you can get the customer feedback and implement it so that there will be no surprises at the end of the project, and be aware of flow deaths in your system. Okay, so these are different tools and techniques for predictability. I have listed many of the tools I have been using for the past 3 years, and I'm not going in depth with them, but I will suggest some of the books you can read about them. So this is a Kanban. Kanban is a technique where you have a flow, where you, you know, closely monitor the flow of each task in the system. So these are some of the techniques: work in progress, number of items you are working on at present, at given point of time, how many tasks you are working on or your development team is working. Then cycle time, time takes one task to complete. Then throughput, work completed per unit of time. Then Little's Law. Little's Law is an average of all this, whatever I said here, work in progress, cycle time, and throughput. And basing on this, it will help you to, you know the predictability and system stability. And these are cumulative flow diagrams. If you see, you will identify which step in your process is taking much long. For example, here if you see, there is a testing phase, there is a development phase, there is a design phase, then there is a you know, production deployment phase. Every phase is listed out here. So when you see the cumulative flow diagram, you can tell which particular step in your process is taking more time and act accordingly on you know, optimizing that particular steps. Say for example, you have identified in cumulative flow diagrams, you have identified that your testing team is taking so much of time. You can look into it, what's happening. Is the testing team is not available, or are they, did they go on holidays, or don't they have enough tools to test the system or test the project? What's happening? What is the reason it is taking so much time? So you will be able to see the cumulative flow diagram, identify which step of your process is taking time, and then further investigate it. Then there is Scrum, of course, many of us are familiar. These are some of the techniques: velocity of the team, which is nothing but again throughput. How much in one sprint, how many tasks your team was able to deliver. Then customer satisfaction, you can take service from your customer. Then technical debt, number of bugs you have encountered in a sprint. Why? What is the reason? So other techniques, there are fishbone analysis. This is a cause and effect technique where you can basically go from backwards. So say for example, your development team has created a newsletter, but the newsletter is not effectively getting delivered, or it is going into spam. What is the reason? So you will start from the effect and go back. What is the cause? What is the cause? What is the cause? And there are five whys. So you'll go to the team and you will ask why. Why this has happened? Why? For example, here say, run through the red light. Why? Late for work. Why? Woke up late. Why? Alarm clock broke. Why? Didn't clock if it is worked. Why? Forgot in the night. So five whys. You will identify what are the five reasons that particular task has failed, and you will try to solve it. So one thing to take into consideration is any metric, whether Kanban, Scrum, or any other process metrics, will only help you to identify where the problem lies, in which area the problem lies, why the problem has occurred, and what to do to eradicate the problem is again up to you to investigate. As I said, if my testing team is not able, I mean, there is a large gap in testing team, the testing team is taking long time and effort is long, it is up to me to go to them and talk to them and understand why it is taking long time. Metrics or data or all these charts will not show you why the problem exists. It only will show you where the problem exists. So some of the tools I have used, Edsel, Anfiddle, actionableagile.com is one of the websites where you can, it's a purchase tool, but again, it's a very good, to generate charts and all, atlassian.com, Jira, kanbanize.com, And these are the, some of the books if you want to refer, if you want to understand more about cumulative flow diagram, Little's law, scatter plots, histograms, all this kind of, these are the, some of the books. Actionable Agile by Daniel Vacanti, Practical Kanban for, by Klaus Leopold, Software in 30 Days, Lean UX, all these books are provide wonderful insights. They will in detail explain how these charts and data will help you to, measure your metrics, measure with your metrics. So these are some key takeaways. Tools and techniques will aid you in measuring. They will identify the problem areas, not the problem itself or the solution. You need to investigate. You need to talk to the people. Only you can solve the problems. No metrics or no charts can solve problems. Metrics helps us in stabilizing the system. Stability enhances our chances of predictability. So whenever we talk to the customer, the first thing our customer asks, when it will get over, when it will get delivered. That is nothing but predictability. If you want to be very accurate with your predictability, use all these tools and techniques. It will help you aid you in predictability, telling your client that this particular thing will completed by this time. At least guess. So at least with some 80 to 90% of confidence. And that is called SLE, service level expectation, which is another technique in Kanban. So, okay, coming to our last part, this is, if we go through all these things, it is very, fearing, very scaring. When first I went through this, all books and all the tools and techniques, and I really got scared. I thought, no way I'm going to do all these things. And that is not because essentially I don't understand it or I don't want to understand it. Essentially, I was scared because I was very reluctant to accept the change. So we are very happy with what, sometimes we are very happy with what we have. But when there are times we need to change ourselves, there will be times we need to change ourselves, there will be times we need to adapt new technologies or adapt new processes. But we fear it. Basically, we fear change. So how we embrace change? Again, coming to my personal experience here, and we built an entertainment portal for one of the MNCs, Diageo. I'm saying it loud because it was already put up in our website. So I have the flexibility to say it. So Diageo is one of the brand which is situated in United Kingdom. It's headquartered in England. So for them, what we did is we have migrated, we have built an entirely new portal with the entire rebranding strategy where we have where this list of tasks have been involved. We had content migration from old portal to new portal. Then we had used page layout management of Drupalit to build campaign pages. Then we have customized schemas for SEOs. All these are Drupal related terms, but still. So these are very detailed, and Drupalit is relatively new to the market. So we were experimenting with it, then we are building it. We are doing so many activities here. So what happened here is, so there are user stories which we have created, and the user stories will actually go to the development team, our HTML, CSS, PHP guys, they're standing and they're giving it. Then there is a one lead developer who integrates all their work, and there is a testing team, and there is a client approval, and there is a production deployment of the production. On top of it, there is a scrum master and there is an infrastructure guys who are sitting on the top and intervening whenever necessary. So what happened is, in this project, half of the team members, we are a 9-member team in this project because it's a very large entertainment portal and we had many new things built for them. What essentially happened is, in the 9-member team, half of our college graduated freshers, and they were working with us. So when we went to them and when we explained the process, in this particular project, we have used both Scrum and Kanban. We have used tools and techniques from both Scrum and Kanban. And when we explained them the process, they were, first 2 days, nobody spoke even one little word. They were very scared. One is they understand the technology, but they don't understand the process, and this is change for them. They were very scared. So what we did is we sat them. We literally sat them. We sat on the floor. We sat on the floor. We ordered pizzas. We sat with them and we explained them why this is important for us. Why following this particular process is important for us. Why sprints are important for us. Why using metrics and tools. Why sprint burn down charts or cumulative flow diagrams. All these are important for us. How we can, you know, predict the system, how we can calculate whether we are going in the right direction or not using the system, we explained to them. Then after a couple of weeks, they started embracing the change, embracing the system. Then they started working with them. And these guys are fantastic guys. They are technically very sound and capable guys. The only thing is they need to understand why the process is there. And one thing I would like to tell you all is transformation is only can only led by people. Only people can bring transformation. And if you want people to bring the transformation, don't throw something into their faces. We should not go to them and say that you need to follow this because company's rules are this. You explain them why company has such rules. Then they will understand it, they will embrace it. Then you will able to get actual results from them. So this is one of the fantastic projects we had in, especially in my 3 years of experience, because we had many, I myself has realized why I'm following this process. So some of the causes we don't embrace change is silo thinking. Silo thinking is nothing but there are different teams in an organization. These teams sometimes what they do is they will be reluctant to share information with one another. So again, coming back to the point, don't manage teams, manage the interactions. Don't go to the particular individual and say you have to perform better. Say to him, you need to work with your friend or with your colleague and you need to perform better. And be a multiplier, not a diminisher. So basically I will say what is the difference between a multiplier and diminisher. Multiplier is a person who realizes everyone's capability. He will realize that everyone has potential and he will, take that potential from all the persons, combine it and subsequently use it for the large good, a greater good. So that is multiplier. Whereas diminisher, he's a micromanager. So he solely makes decision. He will not consider anyone. He thinks he knows everything. So that is a personality of diminisher. If you really want to survive in an organization or to lead people, not to boss people, but lead people, be a multiplier. Identify each and every individual's, traits, qualities, what they have good, what they have bad. Include the good. Sometimes you need to ignore the bad sometimes, or if you can correct it, correct the bad. If you are not able to correct it, ignore it. But take the good, integrate all the good and produce a greater product. That's how you can go forward in an organization. And top to bottom approach. Many times what happens is in organization management thinks that when they want to bring a change, they need to start from operational level. But I don't think so that will work. Why? Because when you see someone as your leader, when you see someone as your boss, you get inspired by them. You think to yourself that 5 years from now, I want to be him or I want to be in his place. A real boss, when you are very happy with your job. I'm really happy with my job. So I think I see my boss or I see my manager and I think that in 5 years, I have to be in their place. And if you want to be in that place, first they need to walk the talk. If they want to bring a change into organization, first themselves has to adapt that change and then ask us to change. So any change embracement or any transformation should be top to bottom approach, not bottom to top approach. And these are the key takeaways. So as I said, only people can bring transformations and you need to explain reasons and benefits. Why do you want to bring instead of throwing them into the face and instead of commanding them to do something. and always make team understand the end value they are creating. So again, subscription or subscribe a newsletter. When a developer creates a subscription blog, make him understand why he's doing it. It's not just he's creating some blog. It's not just he's taking some SMTP details and he's configuring a newsletter. Understand him. If a developer configuring a newsletter for learning portal or a student portal, you make him understand that by using the newsletter you have configured, these number of students are getting benefited. They know the programs that are running in that particular organization. They will be able to study. Always, always show the big picture to your team. Make them understand that they are not doing some mundane task. Picking a color, choosing a color, or putting a block here and there. It's all mundane tasks. But if you are able to communicate with your team what is the end result or what is the end value they are delivering, they will be more enthusiastic. They will be more, they will have more morale. So always communicate with your team what is the end result. And as I explained, to eradicate silo thinking, don't manage people, manage interactions. And always introduce the change. If you want to introduce the change, always take from top to bottom approach. Don't go from bottom to top. It will ultimately lead to, your team will think, oh, hey, he's not doing anything, but he's asking me to do, or she's not doing anything, but she's asking me to do. So don't give that kind of thought to them. You first implement that within yourself or within your colleagues, and then take that to the team you are working with. That is how you can deliver a successful project, I guess. Okay, that's all from my side. Thank you so much. And if any questions are there, in nutshell, yes. But you need to identify what kind of customer value you want to deliver and what kind of method best suits for it. Okay? So, can you just give me some more information what kind of project it is? Yes. Okay. Yes, Agile works in it, but only thing is, when it comes to fixed projects, what happens is, generally you won't be able to accommodate changes, correct? So, one thing you can do is, you can tell to your customer, there is something called DOR, definition of ready. So, what happens is, when the client comes to you and says that this is my requirement, essentially people who follow Kanban techniques, what they will do is they will measure something called DOR. So they will say, they will take a document, they will write DOR. What is the definition of ready? When you say particular task is ready for the implementation, point 1, point 2, point 3, point 4. If these 4 points are met, I will take this particular functionality and start implementing it. If these 4 points are not met, I won't take. That is how they will follow. In Fixed-bit projects, this is one of the technique you can use. You can say, you can formulate some DORs, definition of ready, and say to the client, only when this criteria are met, or only when this few points are met, I will start implementing it. So that it will reduce the changes. You will not be able to adopt the changes. So it will reduce the changes, one thing. And second thing is, it will help not to deviate from the project, not to deviate from the functionality. That is one of the technique. But you can, if you go and refer, you can come up with some more techniques. But yes, Agile definitely can help Fixed-bit projects. Yeah, it will work. It will work, but only thing is, you need to identify right techniques, right? Tools and techniques which you can adapt for it. Anything, any more questions? Okay. Thank you so much.